So let's get started. Good morning, all of you. So any questions from yesterday's class? I'm repeatedly saying, unless you put some effort, you are not going to have any questions, okay? So, and whatever we covered is very important because it is a general two-dimensional boundary value problem. So I suggest you be serious and put effort. And in yesterday's class, I was discussing about these two examples or two questions that are given in assignment 6, okay? The first question and the second question. Basically, these two questions, you need to actually start from the basic principles or if you carefully go through whatever is covered, let me show you. So this is the general two-dimensional boundary value problem that we looked at. And here, these are the boundary conditions, essential boundary condition, natural boundary condition. And for this problem, if you apply variational method or Rayleigh-Grigge method, this is the equivalent functional, okay? And then subsequently, to simplify this, we need to substitute finite element approximation of these field variables. And here, it is directly given for this problem, this is the equivalent functional, and if you want to cross-check this, whether this equivalent functional that is given here is indeed correct one for this problem or not, then you can adopt this procedure which is given below. Okay, so this is the equivalent functional. If you apply adopt this variational method, and if you want to solve this problem, you want to solve this general two-dimensional boundary value problem using Galerkin method, the procedure is, in terms of the finite element approximation, the procedure is explained here. Multiply the given differential equation on either side with weight function, integrate over the problem domain. So that is the first step in Galerkin criteria. So you need to keep these things in mind, okay? And now coming back to these two examples or two questions that are asked here, and here let's read this, then you will understand better. Using modified Galerkin method, find an approximate solution of following boundary value problem defined over a rectangular domain. So we need to solve this differential equation over this rectangular domain subjected to these boundary conditions. What are the boundary conditions? The field variable derivative evaluated on C1 is equal to 0. Evaluated field variable derivative with respect to y. Evaluated on C1. What is C1? Please take a note of this, the figure here. And because we are going to discuss in today's class about this problem. And basically these two questions, you are asked to solve, if you remember, for one-dimensional problems, what we did, we started out with classical methods. We started out before we got into the finite element, substitution. What we started out with is a polynomial trial solution. But making it admissible, and then substituting that admissible trial solution into the equivalent functional or into the Galerkin criteria, we develop the solution procedure. Same way we need to do here. So here, basically, question one, question two, when it is mentioned one parameter, two parameter trial solution that is admissible, it means you need to adopt classical methods. Okay, so now. So to come up with a trial solution which is admissible, this whatever discussion I'm presenting, that is going to be helpful, okay? So what is this C1? In this problem, in the figure, if you see, C1 is nothing but y is equal to 0. What is the equation of C1? Y is equal to 0. Equation of C4 is x is equal to 0. Equation of C3 is y is equal to 0.5. Equation of C2 is x is equal to 1. So take a note of these the boundary conditions that are given. Derivative of the field variable with respect to y is equal to 0 along C1. That means along y is equal to 0 if we evaluate. Along y is equal to 0 if we evaluate, the derivative of field variable is equal to 0. And also, derivative of field variable with respect to x evaluated on C4. C4 is nothing but y, x is equal to 0. So field variable derivative evaluated with respect to x along x is equal to 0 is 0. Okay, so the two natural boundary conditions are derivative of field variable with respect to y evaluated along y is equal to 0 is 0. Derivative of field variable with respect to x evaluated at x is equal to 0 is 0. So that those are the two natural boundary conditions. What are the essential boundary conditions? Essential boundary conditions are this one. Field variable value along C2 and C3 is equal to 0. C2 is nothing but field variable evaluated along x is equal to 1 is 0, and also field variable evaluated along y is equal to 0.5 is 0. So you need to make a note of all this because we need to come up with admissible trial solution. One parameter or two parameters. Okay? So this is about this problem. So if you want to adopt Galerkin method as suggested here, what you need to do is you multiply with the weight function. What is weight function? Weight function, if you recall, if you go back to your one-dimensional problems, let me go back to one-dimensional problems and then show you, then you will understand better the relation. In one-dimensional boundary value problem, Galerkin method, basic form, or modified Galerkin method, the same weight function is going to be said. What is weight function? Weight function is the derivative of admissible trial solution with respect to the unknown parameter. This is for one dimension. Here u is function of x alone. Now in our case, the field variable is function of x and y. But the weight function definition is going to remain same. Weight function for Galerkin method is partial derivative of the admissible trial solution with respect to the unknown coefficients. So this criteria we need to adopt. Okay, this weight function definition we need to adopt here. Instead of finite element shape function for solving one and two problems, you need to adopt that weight function. So now let me come back to this one. So this is about the first problem. Once you got the weight function, integration by parts, all those things are going to remain same. And in two-dimensional problems, you need to adopt the Green's theorem, okay? And then you need to simplify. And then you are going to get, automatically you are going to get set of equations you need to solve. We will see one example, then it will be clear to you. So what I suggest is you need to spend some time on one and two problems. I'm going to give you a hint, and then based on that you can proceed, okay? And similarly, Rayleigh-Grage method or variational method. In variational method, if you see this in the whatever we discussed for two-dimensional problems here, for general two-dimensional boundary value problem, the equivalent functional is directly given here. But if you want to really start from basic principles, what you need to do is you need to multiply this equation on either side with variation of field variable, integrate over the problem domain, apply this one, integration by parts and Green's theorem, and then simplify. And then you need to use some admissible trial solution to get the equations, okay? So that is how you can proceed for this second problem. But before that, what is admissible trial solution? What admissible trial solution I need to select? I need to select such a way these boundary conditions are satisfied. So what are the essential boundary conditions here? This is a two-dimensional boundary value problem. So those boundary conditions of order 0 are essential. Those boundary conditions of order 1 are natural boundary conditions. So essential boundary condition is U, as a, here, even though it is written U, U is, it's a two-dimensional problem. So U is function of X and Y. U evaluated along C1 is X squared. What is C1? C1 is nothing but Y is equal to 0. So let's make a note of these boundaries, okay? C1 is Y is equal to 0. C2 is X is equal to 1. C3 is Y is equal to 1. C4 is X is equal to 0. So these are the equations. So U value evaluated along C1, which is Y is equal to 0, should be X squared. U evaluated along C4, which is Y, X is equal to 0. U evaluated along X is equal to 0 should be Y squared. These are the essential boundary conditions. Natural boundary conditions are specified along C2 and C3. Is this clear? So based on this, you need to come up with admissible trial solution. Afterwards, you need to start from basics and get the equations. Okay? So to get you more idea about solving these two problems or problems of this kind of nature, here, before I proceed for higher order elements, last class we looked at three-node triangular element. Before we proceed for that, I want to just take a slight deviation and discuss about what we missed out. We did not discuss for two-dimensional problems, we did not discuss classical methods. We directly jumped in using finite element method, but these two questions are related to classical methods. So I want to just spend some time on that. Yesterday, I sent you email about giving you an idea about an example of similar nature, which you can go through it, and then you can solve this problem. That example I want to go through in today's class, and afterwards we'll go for higher order elements. Okay, so this is what I sent you by email, and same is posted on the Moodle. So this is the example. So please take a note of this one. Please take a note of this problem. So once you understand this one, you can easily solve those two assignment problems, assignment 6, 1 and 2 problems. So please take a note of this. So we need to solve this differential equation, which is basically a Poisson's equation. A second partial derivative of u with respect to second derivative, okay? Second derivative of u with respect to x plus second derivative of u with respect to y is equal to 0. We need to solve this two-dimensional boundary value problem over this rectangular domain, which is going from x from 0 to 2 and y from 2 to minus 2 or minus 2 to 2. And this is a second order boundary value problem. So those boundary conditions of order 0 are essential boundary conditions. Those boundary conditions of order 1 are natural boundary conditions. So essential boundary conditions are U evaluated on C1, C3, C4. C1 is nothing but Y is equal to minus 2. C3 is nothing but Y is equal to 2. C4 is X is equal to 0. So U evaluated on these three lines, that is Y is equal to 2, Y is equal to minus 2, and X is equal to 0, U should be equal to 0. and derivative of u with respect to x along c2. C2 is nothing but x is equal to 2 should be equal to 1. So please take a note of this. I'm going to explain to you how can you make an intelligent guess for this kind of problems, how to make an intelligent guess for admissible trial solution. Okay, so please take a note of this. So if you completely understand this problem, then you can easily solve assignment problems 1 and 2. Assignment problems 1 and 2, assignment 6, 1 and 2 problems can be solved if you understand this problem. And basically, instead of adopting finite element method, we want to adopt classical method starting with an admissible trial solution. So please take a note of it. And please focus on this one. Please focus on this boundary conditions. These are essential boundary conditions. U, first of all, u is function of x and y. U is the field variable. It's a two-dimensional problem. So u is going to be a function of x and y. And what this boundary condition says is u is equal to 0 evaluated on y is equal to minus 2, y is equal to 2, x is equal to 0. So this information can be used to come up with an intelligent guess for trial solution. So u as a function of x and y should be equal to 0 along y is equal to minus 2. Y is equal to minus 2 can be written as y plus 2 is equal to 0. Please take a note of it. Y is equal to minus 2 can be written as y plus 2 is equal to 0. So u is equal to 0 along y plus 2 is equal to 0, y minus 2 is equal to 0, and x is equal to 0. So u, the admissible trial solution for u, should consist these three terms, y plus 2, y minus 2, and x. From your basic mathematics, which you studied as a part of high school, y minus 2 plus y plus 2 is y square minus 4. So this admissible trial solution should consist of a term which is y square minus 4, which is nothing but y plus 2 multiplied by y minus 2. So admissible trial solution should consist of term y square minus 4, and also it should consist of x. So admissible trial solution should consist of y square minus 4 times x. In addition, other terms can be there. Okay? In addition, other terms can be there. Is it clear? So please take a note of it. Unless you take a note of it, this is not like no regular course where I can write in the blackboard and then where you can make a note in your notebooks. So when I'm dictating, you please take a note of it. This is how you can make an intelligent guess on the admissible trial solution. So this boundary condition, to satisfy this boundary condition, u as a function of x and y, that trial solution should consist of y square minus 4 term, and also x term should be there. In addition to that, other terms will be there. What are the other terms? You look at the natural boundary condition. Natural boundary condition is saying derivative of u with respect to x evaluated on c2. C2 is x is equal to 2, is equal to 1. So derivative of u evaluated along this line, which is x is equal to 2, the slope of u with respect to x evaluated along this line should be equal to 1. And if you integrate it, what you are going to get? if you integrate it, you are going to get, this is a constant. This is a constant, the slope is constant, slope of u with respect to x is constant along c2. If I integrate it, I'm going to get a linear equation in terms of x. So what I'm going to get if I integrate it, I'm going to get a linear equation that is going to be of nature a0 plus a1x. A0 plus a1x is going to be the nature. Here I am taking partial derivative with respect to x. That's why I'm saying a0 plus a1x. Suppose here the derivative is with respect to y, then it's going to be a0 plus a1y. So a0 plus a1x, to take care of this, a0 plus a1x should be, term also should be there in the admissible trial solution. So now we noted what term should be there to satisfy this essential boundary condition, and what terms can be there to satisfy or to at least approximately satisfy this natural boundary condition. So here I should have y square minus 4 times x, and here I should have a0 plus a1x. So now I got a complete idea what should be the trial solution, admissible trial solution. Admissible trial solution is going to be a0 plus a1x multiplied by y square minus 4 times x. So that is going to be the admissible trial solution for this problem. Okay? So I hope that discussion is clear. If there are any questions or comments, you please let me know. Otherwise, we'll proceed further. Okay, I hope you have taken note of this problem. So now let's proceed. How to proceed? We need to decide whether we want to use Galerkin method or variational method. Here, let's see what is used. So this is whatever this figure is there, the statement is written in plain English here. Find an approximate solution of the following boundary value problem. Solve this Poisson equation over this domain subjected to these boundary conditions. So if you want to take a note of this, once again, please note that I shared with you all these slides. Also, it is posted on Moodle, but don't take it like it's already available, so I can go through it. Don't have that kind of attitude. You please take a note of it, okay? Then it will be better for your understanding. So please take a note of it. I'm going to wait for a minute. When we were dealing with one-dimensional problems and subsequently later, I used to get some questions or comments from students. But now after starting two-dimensional problem, there are no questions. I'm not clear whether you are following or not. So please let me know if you have any questions. Please don't lose interest already. We just started two-dimensional problems. So still we need to complete three-dimensional problems. And the last day of instruction is middle of May 15th. Okay. So still we need to cover a lot of things. So you just don't lose interest. And if you have any questions or anything, let's discuss. Okay. So this is, if you want to put this, whatever is depicted in this figure, if you want to put it in plain English or in terms of algebraic equations, this is how you can write that problem statement. So now, here the solution procedure is explained using adopting Galerkin method. Given boundary value problem, multiply with the weight function, integrate over the problem domain. First step. this weight function is also going to be two-dimensional weight function. It's going to be a function of x and y. Okay? So please take a note of it. And here, this is second derivative of u with respect to x, second derivative of u with respect to y. So the next step is integration by parts, as you did for one-dimensional problems. And also, we need to apply Green's theorem, integration by parts along with Green's theorem. So we'll do one thing. There are two terms here, partial derivative of u with respect to x, second derivative of u with respect to x, multiplied by this weight function, integrated over this two-dimensional domain, plus second derivative of u with respect to y multiplied with weight function integrated over two-dimensional domain. So let's split it into two parts, and each of the terms, let's see how they can be simplified. And we need to use these formulas. When we were discussing in conjunction with finite element method, I already brought to your notice these equations. I hope you have taken note of it. Here, u is missing. There is a typing mistake. U is missing here. V is missing here. U times partial derivative of v with respect to x integrated over two-dimensional domain. And this is by integration by parts. And here, this is coming from Green's theorem. Area integral is converted into line integral. Similarly, here it is derivative, is partial derivative with respect to x. Here it is with respect to y. And you can read this. U as a function of x and y, v as a function of x and y are functions defined over an area A with boundary S. And these are two identities or formulas. So we'll be making use of this. So we'll be making a use of these two equations to simplify these two terms. First term is with respect to partial derivatives with respect to x. Second term is partial derivative with respect to y. Here, derivative is taken two times. Derivative is taken two times. Whereas weight function is not having derivative. So we are going to transfer one derivative to the weight function using these two formulas. So if you apply these two terms becomes this. So please take a note of this. I'm going very slow, understand, hoping that it will be clear to you. So these two terms now, we can put them together and we can join these two terms, from this equation, second term, this one we can join them together. Like this. I already told you what is the meaning of an x and an y. Nx and y are nothing but your unit normals along x and y direction. They're also same as direction cosines of outer normal, the normal which is pointing outward. Please take a note of it, just a minute. Hello. Yes. No, I am not interested. If I am interested, I will get back to you. Okay. Good. So please take a note of this. Okay. So now, please note that these are general equations, and here A is some two-dimensional domain, S is some boundary. But now coming to the specific, what is this A? What is this A for this specific problem that the domain that we are looking at? A is nothing but with x going from 0 to 2 and y going from minus 2 to 2. So we need to solve over this. So based on this, our limits of integration are going to be that to evaluate that area of integral, x limits are going to be from 0 to 2 and y limits are going to be minus 2 to 2. So we need to integrate that that area integral over this domain. And also, what is boundary? Boundary is C1, C2, C3, C4 comprises of boundary. So C1, we need to evaluate that line integral along this line. And please note that you need to adopt consistent direction in which you are evaluating. Always either go in the counterclockwise direction or clockwise direction. So evaluate from here. X is equal to 0 to x is equal to 2. That is for C1. Y is equal to minus 2 to y is equal to 2 for C2. And for C3, x is equal to 2 to x is equal to 0. And for C4, y is equal to 2 to y is equal to minus 2. So you either adopt counterclockwise or clockwise direction, consistent. So that information is what is you adopted here. Okay? That information is what is adopted. Here, negative sign is there. X limit is from 0 to 2. Y limit is from minus 2 to 2. So that is what is written. Area integral. And what about this second integral? Second one, line integral. Here, this is a plus sign. So nx, ny are there. Nx, ny are there. So what is nx, what is ny? So we need to make a note of nx, ny for these all these boundaries. C1, what is outer normal? For C1, what is the outer normal? Normal which is pointing outwards. You need to use right-hand thumb rule. Okay? You need to use right-hand thumb rule. Here you are going from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to 2. X is equal to 0 to x is equal to 2. So how to use right-hand thumb rule? You put your, here, this is my right hand. I hope you are able to see. This is my starting point, x is equal to 0. This is my ending point. This point is ending point, x is equal to 2. The direction in which thumb is pointing, that is the direction of outer normal. That is the direction of outer normal. So for C1, outer normal is going to be in the negative y direction. So ny is going to be 0, nx is going to be 0, ny is going to be minus 1. You please make a note of it. These are all very important, okay? And similarly for C2, what is the starting point? This is the starting point, this is the ending point. So starting point, ending point. You can see here how I am putting my right hand. So this tip is starting point, this tip is ending point, and thumb is pointing outward in the positive x direction. Thumb is pointing in the positive x direction. Nx is equal to 1, ny is equal to 0. And similarly here, outward normal for C3 is nx is equal to 0, ny is equal to 1. And this one for C4, nx is equal to minus 1, ny is equal to 0. So let me summarize. For c1, nx is going to be 0, ny is going to be minus 1. C2, nx is going to be 1, ny is going to be 0. C3, nx is going to be 0, ny is going to be 1. C4, nx is going to be minus 1, ny is going to be 0. Since this is a rectangular domain, suppose these edges are nicely oriented along the axis. That's why we can easily write. But if you see real situation, these lines need not be nicely oriented with respect to x-axis, y-axis. They may be inclined. So along the inclined line, you are going to have components of both nx and ny. How to determine that, we will see later. Okay? So is this clear? So you got nx, ny values for all the boundaries. And also, you make a note of these boundary conditions. Okay? You make a note of these boundary conditions. U is equal to 0 along C1, C3, C4. And derivative of U with respect to X along C2 is equal to 1. So now, with all that, you can simplify this. So S comprises of C1 plus C2 plus C3 plus C4. And along C1, nx is going to be 0, ny is going to be minus 1. C1 goes from x is equal to 0 to x is equal to 2. C2, nx is equal to 1, ny is equal to 0. And it goes from minus 2 to 2. And C3 is going to be nx is equal to 0, ny is equal to 1. It goes from x is equal to 2 to x is equal to 0. C4, nx minus 1, ny is 0. It goes from 2 to y is equal to 2 to y is equal to minus 2. Substitute all that information and check whether this is going to be correct or not. So based on the discussion, since the sides C1, C3, C4 involve essential boundary condition, the boundary integral is 0 except along C2. If we use admissible trial solution, then the weight function, please note that what we study, if we use admissible trial solution, the weight function evaluated along the boundaries where along the sides along which essential boundary condition is specified, at that location weight function is going to be 0. If you recall, you just go back to your one dimensional boundary value problem and check all that. If you had forgotten that, please look at it, okay? Wherever you specify the essential boundary condition, if you are adopting variational method, variation of admissible trial solution is equal to 0. Variation of admissible trial solution is similar to the weight function. So weight function is going to be 0 wherever you specify the along the edges, wherever you specify essential boundary conditions, weight function is going to be 0. That is the reason. Since sides C1, C3, C4 involves essential boundary conditions, the boundary integral is 0 because here weight function is there. So whatever is maybe the quantity inside the square bracket, you are multiplying with 0, it's going to be 0. So this integral you need to evaluate only along c2. C2 goes from y is equal to 2 to y is equal to y is equal to minus 2 to y is equal to 2, and along c2 nx is equal to 1, ny is equal to 0, nx is equal to 1, ny is equal to 0. So this term is going to drop off, this term is going to be 1, this is going to be 1. So it's simply partial derivative of u with respect to x multiplied by the weight function evaluated at x is equal to 2. So this is it. And now you substitute what is the natural boundary condition. It's equal to 1. So then simplify this. This is going to be that. So now this is what we got after applying integration by parts and Green's theorem and simplifying all these things for this particular domain. We got this one. Now we need to substitute admissible trial solution. So now that for that we whatever explanation or whatever discussion I had in the beginning of this, that is going to be useful. So admissible solution, how it's going to be looking like based on the discussion that I gave in the beginning of this today's class. Based on the discussion we had, I told you to make a note of it. Admissible trial solution is going to be a naught plus a1x multiplied by x multiplied by y square minus 4. So that is one of the admissible trial solution. I'm not saying that is the only admissible trial solution. Based on the nature of the boundary condition and other things, that is what I'm guessing. So that is what here. Admissible trial solution, or if you take admissible trial solution like this, it satisfies all the essential boundary conditions. Instead of a naught plus a1x, it is written here a1 plus a2x. So this is the admissible trial solution. Once you get admissible trial solution, you take derivative of admissible trial solution with respect to the unknown parameters, you are going to get the weight functions. This is partial derivative of u with respect to x. Okay. And here you can also make whether this admissible trial solution is satisfying essential boundary conditions or not. So that check is made here. In fact, it satisfies all the essential boundary conditions. So this is the admissible trial solution, derivative of it. And what about the weight function? And this weight function also you can check whether this weight function is zero, whether this weight function is zero along C1, C3, C4. C1 is nothing but y is equal to minus 1. So you see this weight function W1, y is equal to, along y is equal to minus 2, whether this weight function is going to be zero or not. Substitute y is equal to minus 2. Substitute y is equal to minus 2 here. It's going to be 0. Both the weight functions are 0. And weight function is going to be 0 along C1, C3. C3 is nothing but y is equal to 2. Check whether these weight functions are 0 or not. And also C4. C4 is nothing but x is equal to 0. So check these weight functions whether they are going to be 0 or not. So if you do properly, if you use proper admissible trial solutions and then do all the algebra correctly, the weight functions satisfy the condition that there would be zero along the boundaries on which you apply essential boundary conditions. So you got the weight functions, derivative of weight functions. You substitute all this information in this and simplify this. There are two weight functions, so selecting each weight function separately, you get two equations. You solve these two equations. There are two parameters, a1 and a2, to be determined. And solving this, this is going to be the approximate solution for this problem. So you need to adopt similar kind of procedure to solve this, to solve assignment problem 1 and 2. Assignment 6, 1 and 2. And here, whatever procedure that is explained here is with respect to Galerkin method, but you can adopt similar procedure and then work out all the details if you adopt the variational method. So that is what you need to do for second problem of assignment 6. Any questions here? Any questions? So I'm going to give you a hint for assignment problem. Okay, so I'm going to give a hint for this problem. Okay, so with whatever discussion we had for the example problem, you can see here the field variable is psi here. Psi is equal to 0 along C2 and C3. What is C2? C2 is nothing but x is equal to 1. C3 is y is equal to 0.5. X is equal to 1 can be written as x minus 1 is equal to 0. And C3 can be written, or C3 is nothing but y is equal to 0.5, which is nothing but y minus 0.5 is equal to 0. So the admissible trial solution for psi should consist of these two terms. X is equal to minus 1, y is equal to, or y, x minus 1 and y minus 0.5. These two terms should be there. Okay? And what about this? Field variable derivative with respect to y along C1. C1 is nothing but y is equal to 0. Along y is equal to 0, this field variable derivative with respect to y is equal to 0. You take integral of it, then psi should be function of x. If you take, what is the meaning of this? Partial derivative of psi with respect to y is equal to 0 along C1. That means psi is not function of y. Psi is not function of y along C1. So psi is function of x. Okay? And similarly, psi is function of y along C4. So this admissible trial solution should also consist of some x squared term and y squared term. X squared term. So if I have y squared term here, partial derivative of psi with respect to y is going to give me 2y. And evaluated at y is equal to 0 is going to be 0. Similarly, if I have x squared term, partial derivative of x, if I take a partial derivative of psi with respect to x, I'm going to get 2x, and evaluated at x is equal to 0 is going to be 0. So, and also it is mentioned here, simple one or two parameter trial solution. So with that, I will show you, this is what my guess value is, okay? Sorry, not the, yeah, this one. Psi is equal to 0 along x is equal to 1. So psi should contain x minus 1 term. Psi is equal to 0 along y is equal to 0.5. So psi should contain y minus 0.5 term. Also here, psi, partial derivative of psi with respect to y evaluated at along y is equal to 0 is 0. So psi, I'm in a class, I will call, who is this? What? Sir, you please call me after 5 minutes. So partial derivative of y with respect to, sorry, partial derivative of psi with respect to y evaluated along y is equal to 0 should be 0. So psi should contain y square term. Similarly, other boundary condition results in conclusion that psi should contain x square terms. Hence, one parameter trial solution that is admissible is, this is a guess. If you don't like, or if you understood this entire concept, you may come up with a different, another different admissible trial solution. So this is the admissible trial solution for this problem, which is one parameter trial solution. So using this, you follow the Galerkin method, and then at the end, you substitute this trial solution and get the equation solved for the, you are going to get only one equation because only one parameter is there. Here only one parameter is there, you are going to get one equation, one unknown, you solve for it. If you want, you can come up with a different admissible trial solution which has two parameters, A1 and A2. Then you are going to get two equations, solve for the two equations. Okay? So that is how you can get for admissible trial solution for this problem. And what I suggest is you put some effort and then try to find what is the admissible, what can be the admissible trial solution for this problem. And let's discuss, okay? And please note that these are not unique. Each student can come up with a different trial solution, okay? So let's discuss on that in the subsequent classes. So this completes two-dimensional problems, solving two-dimensional problems using classical methods or classical approach. In the next class, we'll focus on higher order elements for using Lagrange interpolation formula for two-dimensional problems. So that is this one. Isoparametric quadrilateral elements, 4-node element, 8-node element, such kind of elements. Okay? And these are all based on Lagrange interpolation formula. So these elements are also called Lagrange elements. Lagrange elements are the elements for which shape functions can be derived using Lagrange interpolation formula. We'll see all this in subsequent classes. And some elements we may not be able to derive shape functions using Lagrange interpolation formula. Those elements, they are called serendipity elements. Those elements, how to derive the shape functions and other things, we'll discuss in tomorrow's class or in the subsequent classes. Okay, so that is what is mentioned here. Serendipity element or serendipity shape function. Anyway, I'm going to stop here. I'm not hearing any questions or comments. I don't know whether it's clear or not, but please don't hesitate. If you have any questions, now please raise those things, okay? So let me stop presenting and then take attendance. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.